Welcome to our Dutch Flowers Now Masterclass and to our national and international media joining us from the UK, the USA, Belgium, France, Germany and the Netherlands. My name is Anouk van Ekelen and I work at MBTC as manager of the Destination Development Team. We hope that this masterclass today will inform you that there's more to Dutch flowers than tulips in spring. We hope to show you that there's a wide variety of flowers across the seasons and regions in the Netherlands. Dutch flowers are used innovatively in parades and projects in unexpected ways and increasingly with sustainability measures in place. We will highlight some of these today and in the magazine that you will receive later. Today we are in Westland and we are here shown on the map where we are right now, and I would like to share some facts about the Westland with you. It's known as Glass City. It's the largest area of continuous glass greenhouses in Europe, and it's also known as the green pharmacy of the world. The Westland offers happiness, flowers and plants, and health, vegetable and fruit. The knowledge and skill of greenhouse horticulture in Westland is at Formula One level. People from all over the world come here to learn how to do greenhouse horticulture. And the Varend Corso, the floating flower parade, is one of the largest multi-day events in the Netherlands. It's a large floating showcase of what the Westland has to offer in terms of flowers, plants, vegetables and fruit. It takes place over 4 days on historic boats. Well, now you know where we are. Let's get started. Please remember to use the hashtag DutchFlowersNow in your social media posts and to share that with us. During the masterclass, you can ask questions in the chat function and we will try to answer them during this masterclass or otherwise afterwards. Now, let's get inspired with our Flowers Mood film. Well, let me introduce to you Mathieu van Koppen from Optiflor, and that's what we are right now, and thank you very much. It's very nice that we can host this masterclass from your greenhouse. Let's have a short look in a video what they are doing all here. Very impressive, Mathieu. Can you tell us something more what you do here at Optiflor?
Yeah, What we do here is grow the most beautiful Phalaenopsis in several pot sizes. We have divided a lot of different products in collections. We have for every species a different collection, and we try to make use more time to care and to grow the plant, that the flowering time is much longer than average.
Aha. So that's special. And how many different varieties of orchids do you have?
I think that will be a couple of hundreds.
Wow. But
we try to fit them in concepts. And we have now, at the moment, 29 different concepts. And with that concept, we can make a difference, a distinctive way of Phalaenopsis selling through all Europe. So a lot of our plants go to Germany, but also France, Italy, Austria, Switzerland, and also the UK.
Okay, so mainly Europe is your...
is a main goal,
yeah. Is your main goal and your main market. And how does it work? Is it different from... your company exists already some time. What is different now than it used to be? Because you see a lot of innovations in horticulture.
Yeah.
Can you tell us something about here?
That's the nice thing of the products we produce. They're not regular Phalaenopsis, but there are more concepts, and concepts which are not the standard orchids. In Holland, I think you have 70 different growers, and they all make pot 12, 60 centimeters, two stem. But we always think, can we make something differently? Can we make a short one with big flowers, special colors? We all give them names, and they will become a kind of trademark in Europe. So the high quality florists and garden centers know Optiflor as a brand in Europe. So that's great.
May I ask, what's your personal favorite? Because I hear different colors and different sizes.
Yeah. There are a lot of nice concepts, but I think one of the best now is the Tableau. It's really compact, 40 centimeters high, huge flower, but it fits on a table. So it's very easy to use and to enjoy, actually.
Oh, wow. Well, that's great to hear.
Yeah.
And is there something you would like everybody to know about orchids, that you say we see it in a different way? As you just said, the Dutch people only think of the standard.
Mm-hmm.
Is there something that we all have to know about the orchids, how to keep them good?
I think it's very easy. We also make a lot of special pots with the watering system.
Ah.
So then you don't have to give water every week.
That's
so
easy.
You can go on holiday for 2 or 3 weeks, and you come back and your plant is still in shape.
Well, that's a great innovation for people without green fingers like me.
Yeah, that's the aqua system of Optiflor. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much.
You're
great
welcome.
That we could have a look here inside your greenhouse, and nice to know what you're doing right here. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Mathieu from Optiflor. And now our next guest is Ariane van Zuchtelen, and she's curator at the Mauritshuis in The Hague, a famous museum, and she will tell us a brief history of tulips and flowers in Dutch 7th century art. The floor is yours, Ariane.
Thank you very much. The tulip and Holland are so much connected. It's a symbol of Holland, an iconic flower. But a few people know that, or maybe lots of people know, that the tulip isn't actually indigenous in the Netherlands. It came from the southern Caucasus and only arrived in the Netherlands in the 16th century. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about tulips and Dutch flower painting of the golden age of Dutch painting, which is the 17th century. The blossoming of Dutch painting, was in the 17th century, and one of the new specialties of that time was were flowers still lives, wonderful paintings that didn't actually exist before 1600, before the beginning of the 17th century. What's especially characteristic of those paintings are the rarity, the exotic flowers arranged in big bouquets, different kinds of flowers. And they didn't all blossom in the same season. So it's actually a construction of early blooming flowers in the early spring till the fall. So it's really a construction of having the most beautiful flowers. And in those paintings, the tulip usually plays a role. It's almost always there. Here you see a number of details of those wonderful tulips in Dutch paintings of the time. You notice that the tulips aren't one color. They're always what we call broken tulips, which has this sort of flame-like form. Shall I raise my finger hand? When is the next slide? Has that flame-like form, which makes them the variation of the colors, the big blooming flowers, has made them extremely popular in paintings. As you can imagine, if you look at those wonderful details of those flowers, and they did really well in the Dutch climate. That also helped. Here you see a number of paintings where tulips play the main role in the scene. It's quite rare that you see just one of tulip in a vase, as in the painting on the left. And in the other two paintings, the tulips play the main role. And what is really interesting, that the painting on the right, you see a piece of paper where there's a number of names of all the tulips. What they were creating in that period, you started to create more and more varieties of tulips, that they were mixing the different kinds. It was a huge trade and a huge science as well, which became, of course, very much reflected in Dutch art. This is a wonderful painting of the Mauritshuis by Jan Davidson de Heem, who is perhaps the best known specialist of flower painting of the time. And you see the blossoming of a huge amount of different flowers, extremely colorful. And there's one detail that you see here. It's a bit larger than life, and again, such a flamed tulip that you see in his painting. So those tulips are almost always there. And they didn't realize at the time what the cause was of that pattern in the leaves of the tulip, which actually was caused, it was discovered around 1900, it was caused by a virus. So that made the trade of tulips particularly sensitive, because you never knew what kind of colors, what kind of pattern would come out of the flowers in the next season. This is a portrait of a very important man as we talk about tulips. This is Carolus Clusius, who lived mainly in the 16th century, so a century before this time. He came from the southern Netherlands. He was a botanist, and he was a huge specialist in flowers and a huge collector of plants. And he published the first scientific treatise about the tulip, and he was the man who introduced the tulip in the Netherlands. He was the founder you see a detail of his portrait when he was 75 years old, and you see the very important tulips from in the upper left corner of this print. Here you see the print of the Hortus in Leiden, the Hortus Botanicus, which was founded by Carolus Clusius in 1593. It was the first academic garden in the Netherlands, and Clusius introduced all sorts of plants. He had a huge correspondence with collectors and plant people all around Europe. They exchanged seeds, they exchanged bulbs, they corresponded with each other. And in this garden, which very soon had over 1,000 different plants, he also had the first blooming tulip. What was very important for the tulip was that at a certain point, just before 1600, there was a theft, there was a burglary into the Hortus, and a number of tulips got stolen, which really helped the trade of the tulip afterwards, because the different people became such a huge commodity, they became so expensive in the 17th century that all different different types of planters and people tried to grow the tulip. For those traders in tulips, of course, during the time when the tulips, the bulbs were in the ground between October and May, there was nothing you could show to your clients what the looks of the tulip that you could buy was going to be. So that's why people started to make tulip albums. So wonderful watercolor drawings in those albums that shows the different types of tulips that all have different names as well. And the one that you see here on the right was by a dealer from Haarlem, a botanist dealer and tulip dealer called Pieter Kos. And this is a hugely expensive, as marked with the yellow square. The price of this tulip in 1637 was 4,200 guilders. So it's one of the most expensive tulips that he had for sale in his stock. That the prices of tulips were so high was, of course, the cause of lots of discussion and also some ridicule from the beginning on. It was a trade in something that became more and more of a sort of an wind trade, as we say in Dutch. So and this is a print that illustrates that really well from an emblem book, which in translation says, "A fool and his money can easily be parted," with an illustration of a number of tulips. And later on, that tulip trade grew and grew and was not regulated by a guild system, so that regular people, regular burghers, could actually invest in tulips. And due course of that trade, it became even possible to pay in terms. So they would trade in tulips which were still in the ground. They would change hands a number of times. It was a sort of a pyramid trade, which was bound to go wrong, and it did. In February 1637, there was a huge krach of the tulip trade, and lots of people became completely bankrupt and lost all of their money because of this. And this was the cause of this print that you see here, which ridicules the people that the people on the left all following this triumph car where Flora sits in her seat, and she she's going to be shipwrecked on the right background. And I show you here a detail of Flora with a number of tulips with the different names she has in her left hand. On the left you see the Semper Augustus. That might have been the most expensive tulip that ever was there. There was in 1637, three bulbs of the Semper Augustus were sold for 30,000 Dutch guilders, and the biggest house in Amsterdam's most important canal at that time would have cost 10,000. So you can imagine that it's a huge, enormous price. And after that krach, that go down of the tulip trade in 1637, actually it recovered quite quickly. Tulips continue to be very important in art. They continue to be traded, they continue to be expensive, but the huge story of the tulipomania, as this phase was called, ended in 1637. But people are they learn quite badly, it seems, sometimes, because about 100 years later, early 18th century, there was a similar thing happened to the hyacinths. That became hugely important and much thought after, extremely expensive, and the same thing happened. But it remained in art, those flowers.
Well, thank you very much for this brief and very interesting history.
I'm sorry that the chat function is not working right now. We are working on it, so hopefully it will be back soon. So keep your questions in mind. Thank you, Ariane. And now, from flowers in art, we go to the art of real flowers. Welcome, Doreen van den Berg, from Natural Styler. She is a floral designer, a green stylist, and she's the best to show us how to work with flowers. Doreen is actually a world famous flower stylist. She was born in Noordwijkerhout in the Bulb region, and she has worked in flower installations all over the world, more than 40 countries, from the palaces of the wealthy sheikhs to American TV show of Martha Stewart. And she's made everything from bouquets to tablescapes to wearable floral art. Please, Doreen, tell us something about the latest trends, and can you show us something?
Yes, hello everybody. Welcome in my greenhouse, my little greenhouse here. I put some flowers and plants up here, and I have here some daffodils. And next to tulips, they are also so beautiful. My story of these last 3 years is also to see how can I recycle my own atelier, my own workshop, with all the vases what I have there. And I always work in trends, and I always work with teams, so it's very important to renew the fashion of the flower world. Because when people ask me what I'm doing, I always tell I have 10 red tulips, and every year they need to be new. So what can I do? So Flower Council of Holland is working with four themes. There are more companies that are working with different trends. And because I'm working with trends, I am sometimes already a little bit ahead, and I am then in working. Some of these items are more for 2022. But first, I have a clay pot. And with Corona time, we have all have time to do some handwork. This is raffia, what has been needed. And I want to upscale a new vase in my house. So you can make it every size what you want. And then I'm an easy florist. I am just like, okay, don't make it more difficult than it is. Dried flowers are very fashion. And I thought, okay, I want to make a field bouquet. I always think about, okay, what I'm gonna make, what do I want to do? I just put it in the basket, and then I have this glass vase already filled for today with water, so that my grasses are not gonna be wet, so I can use them again. And then in daffodils, we know them in yellow, but there are so many more different colors and shapes. And look at this little beautiful one. So some are for the garden, some you can buy at a wholesaler. And when you're from England, you're much more famous with daffodils than anybody else. There are about 6,000 pieces in Holland. Well, you can add more if you want, but that's, for me, just keep it simple. We are here in Optiflor, and one of their collections is this perfume one, yeah, that's how you call it. And they have this special bag around it just to give more attention to it. But what I like about the orchids is that lots of them, you buy them with sticks, and that's good for transport. But what I love is to have them without sticks. And when you have a good variety, then you can take easily off the sticks, and you have much more plants. But some people, they really like to have it more straight and more nicely. I'm more the person that likes to have it, and in the wild they go a little bit more down, and then I'm happy with it. I took here for the upcycling. It's for everybody possible, because this is one of the juice bottles at my house. And this was with the wrapping paper for all the things what you get sent by post. But I like the form, I like the shape, and to see, okay, this is what we have done the last few years. I like to have it more in a paper bag now. And I made this one, and I made a bigger one. Because, with lilies. And here you see also adding some dried materials. When I work in my workshop, I have just a table full of dried flowers because I like to see them how they dry in. And that has to do also that dried is so much more famous now because we do want to re-see it and revalue it much more than what we did before. So, and for the last, one of the last pieces, I have a beautiful dried flower. Where were you? So, and then here I have already made for you a big bouquet. But the simple thing is, every vase what you have, and we have a chicken net. And when you just cut a piece, and you see this one is already reused, you make it a little bit more like a bowl, like a vase. And then you kind of put it in your vase. And then you can put any kind of flower easily in your vase. Always put first water inside, but for now. And then it's already with one flower, it's nice. Oh, it's in there. Yeah, and you see, I see with the lilies that a lot of leaves I take off. And I do that because then I see the flower much more. And this lily, maybe you're wondering what it is. It's one of the newest varieties. It's the cocotte. And you have them in orange, yellow, and pink. And they are like 5-6 years on the market. When you see here, this is also a new lily. And it doesn't have any pollen. And this arrangement, I added here also some dried materials in there because I like it to make some refreshment. Some flowers I put more together and some I just do single ones. But what I don't like too much now is that you see the vase with the chicken wire and everything in there. And then I had this piece of wrapping paper. And I thought, okay, next year it's much more bubbles and much more uncontrolled forms. And it looks like a piece of art, this paper. And then you just can bend it around the vase. And with a satay stick, this is a big one from the plants. I missed my one where I put. You just can close it. And this paper comes sometimes in white, and if you want, you can paint it with a natural paint. But that's where you make your own vases, and to be more trendy. And later we come back, and I'm happy that I found this vase, because this is the new kind of form what we will use much more see in 22. Because it's this bubbling, you don't know exactly what the structure is. And when I make a bouquet, because I can make bouquets, then you work also a little bit more bubbling. So I will see you back at the end.
Well, thank you very much, Doreen. It's a good insight in how you can recycle and it can be really on trend. And thank you very much for this contribution.
Okay, you're welcome.
Now we go from the new styles to something very Dutch. The corso. First, a corso is a flower parade in the Netherlands. It can be floating, it can be driving. And Paul Bastiaanse is going to tell us more about it, because Paul Bastiaanse is the chairman at the Federation of All Dutch Flower and Vegetable Parades. Welcome, and shall we watch a video first?
Yes, please.
Okay, let's watch the film about the corsos.
We'll be right back.
This is very impressive, Paul. What can you tell us about it?
Well, it may not come as a surprise that the Netherlands, which is famous for its flowers, hosts also a lot of flower parades. Actually, the density of flower parades is nowhere as large, nowhere in the world as large as in the Netherlands. There are about 30 parades, large and small. And the footage you saw was from the flower parade of Lichtenvoorde in the eastern part of the Netherlands, which is it's one of the biggest flower parades in the world, actually. When you think about flowers in the Netherlands, you think about the spring season and the bulb flowers. And indeed, in the spring season, the spring season has its own flower parade in the Netherlands. But actually, the majority of parades in the Netherlands takes place in August and September and uses dahlia flowers. So not the bulb flowers, but it uses dahlias. And that's because the dahlia season is in August and September. Let's see, like you saw in the movie, the dahlia flower, there is a large spectrum. You can use all kinds of colors. And we don't use it as a flower itself, but we use it more like some kind of paint to cover the three-dimensional surfaces we make. And it gives a very special way of coloring the surface because it's a flower, it's a very live coloring, and it gives also a special texture to the surface. And it's really amazing what you can do with dahlias. It becomes very much alive, and that's something that you can never do with paint, actually. So Anouk, a question for you, because you looked at the movie. How many flowers do you think go on a single float? What would be your guess?
Well, I don't know.
Did you give us a number?
Maybe 10,000 or?
Well, actually, of course, it depends very much on the size of the float. But for the bigger floats, like you saw in the Lichtenvoorde Flower Parade, it's up to 500,000. And we even heard war stories of groups that claim to have much more, and they gave the float builders a hell of a time to finish it in time. Because the dahlia flowers, they have to be put on one by one, by hand. So you stick a nail through it, and then you put it on the surface. And that's done in the last few days before the parade, because if you start earlier, the flowers go bad, of course. So what we typically do is we spend our summer months in the big construction tents where we build our floats, and then in the during the last few days, everyone is involved in putting on the dahlias. So what's important for the flower parades is that it's a competition. So it's groups competing among each other to build the most beautiful float. And there is an independent jury who gives the verdict on what's the most beautiful float. And the fact that it's a competition is very important, because it's an enormous motivation for especially the younger float builders, because they want to win. They want to do it better than the others. And they really go to great length to make the floats bigger, more spectacular, more refined. And you see all kinds of innovations and developments to try to do it as good as possible and to convince the jury that their float is the best. So that competition is really important. And it's all really amazing if you win the parade. And I speak of my own experience, because we did it a few times.
Oh,
and
wow.
It's really, those were the best days of my life. So that's the way it works. But this is also the way that the floats grew so big. So in the biggest parades, the floats are up to 20 meters long and 10 meters high, and they have moving parts, they have sound, they have theater on it, you name it. So there are all kinds of specular developments. What you also saw a bit in the movie is that the float building is not, it's really a community event. It's friends together, it's whole families are involved, people. It's really a big group of people building those floats. And it's not only float building, there are all kinds of social activities next to it that are organized. People eat and drink together, they have parties. They also bring their children to the construction sites. There are classes and workshops for the children and for the young float builders to learn them the art and the craft of float building. And that's the way it develops all the time. And in that way, it's really something that's passed on from generation to generation. And the total number of volunteers Because it's all volunteers, it's entirely non-commercial, and people are doing it for their, well, it's a way of life, we say that, but it's a big hobby. The total number of volunteers involved, actively involved in the flower parades in the Netherlands is about 35,000. So that's a lot of people, and it's really a national hobby float building. And the story I told about the involvement of the generations and the passing on from generation to generation, that's what UNESCO calls intangible heritage. So the fact that it's a very much alive tradition, which changes all the time, it's passed on from generation to generation, but it's actively developing, that's intangible heritage. And we're therefore very proud that the Dutch Corso culture, as we call it, has been signed up for the representative list of intangible cultural heritage of humanity, of UNESCO. Wow. And that decision will be taken at the end of this year, 2021, we're quite sure that that we will succeed in that, and that it will give a lot of visibility and exposure to the Corso culture. Actually, Corso is not a really English word. It's also not really a Dutch word. It's actually Italian, and it means main street, or even something like main street on which social parades are held. And that's typically what we do, of course. You spend the whole summer building the most beautiful float, and then drive it through the main street to show off to the others and to the spectators to see what we did. So of course you can visit them. Like I said, there is one in the spring season, but also in August and September there are many parades throughout the country, from south to north and from east to west. You can even visit preparations if you like, but of course the most spectacular sight is when you visit parade day itself. So be Absolutely. Welcome and come and watch them.
It's very impressive, I can tell from my own experience. Okay. Thank you very much, Paul, for your explanation of this, and we will make sure that we will put the dates to everybody. Thank you very much. And now, from the flower parade, we go to our biggest flower show. Welcome to Annemarie Gerards from Floriade Expo 2022, and you will tell us also something about Flevoland. And well, once every 10 years, Floriade Expo is the park to enjoy the scent and the colors of the flowers, plants, and see the major trends and innovations in horticulture, of course. 2022, the theme is Growing Green Cities, and will you please tell us something more about it?
Thank you. Only 1 year to go to Floriade Expo 2022. Exactly in 1 year, Almere will be the stage for the International Horticultural Exhibition Floriade Expo 2022 on the 14th of April for 6 months. During Floriade, the Dutch horticulture sector will show green solutions that can make cities more fun, livable and sustainable. The team of Floriade Growing Green Cities present the creative, green, sustainable solution. In 2050, 68% of inhabitants in the world live in cities. So that makes that the topic is more important than ever. COVID-19 is the example. We have four sub-teams. Greening the city. How do you make build-up cities greener? With an arboretum, with a greenhouse. Feeding the city. Sustainable food productions for and by cities, eating algae, agroforestry, circular farming, and healthying the city. Feel healthy actively by clean water, clean air, and clean soil. And the fourth one, energizing the city, because new sources of energy are very important. Sustainable energy solutions are necessary. Think about the smart thermal grids. We show bio-based bridges constructed from waste from Almere. We show a bio-based building which is made by cotton or elephant grass or meat cell. The high point, the arboretum. The arboretum, designed by Winnie Maas, one of the Dutch landscape architects, is the green structure of the expo and later on of the urban area Hortus. It is an alphabetical tree and plant encyclopedia that visitors can traverse on foot. from A till Z. At the A plot, you will find, for example, Allium, Agapanthus, Abies, Acer, so all on their botanical names. A beech tree, for example, you will find in the plot of F, of Fagus. All trees and plants contribute to a healthy green city, and this makes this arboretum so unique. Every species has a role in the city of the future. For example, nitrogen emission, CO2 reduction, a greenhouse. The greenhouse complex is where the Dutch horticulture is presented in the broadest sense of word. The whole complex represents the journey through horticulture. A 170 meter long greenhouse is divided into five parts: a reception, a high-tech greenhouse, an experience greenhouse, a technology innovation center, and a greenhouse restaurant. On one of the slides, you saw the cable car. A 150-long cable car ensures a fast and sustainable connection across the Floriade Park. The attraction offers an amazing view, but it's also an example of sustainable urban transport. If you have the slides of the Flevoland building, then I would like to... Yes, thank you very much. Because Flevoland was created by people for people, the largest land reclamation project in the world. Building a whole province from scratch. And this is exactly how Flevoland is made. Land made by man, a good 4 meters below sea level. But Flevoland is never finished. Possibilities for new ideas are always possible. The sky is the limit in Flevoland. And this is the food forum at the Floriade Expo 2022. It's participated by the founder of the province of Flevoland. It's a meeting point and an exhibition about agriculture. Flevoland is an agriculture province. And this food forum shows how we live in Flevoland, more than 4 meters below sea level. And the building is, as it's raised, to sea level. The clay facade refers to the fertile Flevoland soil. And the pavilion is an example of a circular constriction. And at the end of Floriade, here we will see the hectares, 60 hectares of Floriade Expo. Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Well, it's something really to look forward to. And you just said something about the province of Flevoland, which is very unique because it's land made out of water. And I've understood that the minerals create also a great soil for flowers.
Yeah.
So can we watch a video to see how special the flowers in Flevoland are? Floriade Expo. Thank you very much, Annemarie.
Thank you.
And now the really serious things. We're going to talk about Dutch tulip vodka. Welcome, Joris Putman. And will you tell us something more about this and what you're doing at Clusius Craft Distillers?
Yes, well, thank you. Thank you for having me. We make, as you said it, we make vodka from Dutch tulip bulbs. And here it is.
How do you do that? How did you get the idea of doing this? Because
it actually started in a bar.
Of course. All good things start in a bar.
Yeah. And I was just talking with a friend of mine about how to make an innovative spirit. And then suddenly I remembered, and to make a spirit, to make alcohol, mind you, you need either sugar or starch. Like a potato contains a lot of starch, and you can convert the starch into sugar, so you can make alcohol from the sugar with yeast. Okay, that's the chemical part. I was thinking on what kind of ingredients are there with starch and sugar, and then I realized a part of my family has been growing tulip bulbs for, I think, about 300 years. Okay. So I knew there's starch and sugar in a tulip bulb. So I thought, hey, why did no one ever make alcohol from this Dutch icon, which we are so known for in the whole world? And that's how the journey started, with an idea. And we started small. We bought a kettle just to do the test. It came out good. It was possible. And then we started building a distillery. We bought a big kettle. And we developed the taste, we refined the taste so it would be a very pleasant vodka, very gentle. Let's see.
Is it really Dutch water what's in it? Or?
Yeah. We use water, natural filtered water from the Dutch sand dunes. So you get not only the tulip bulbs, but you also get the water from the Dutch sand dunes. That gives it a really nice mineral, gentle undertone, and with, of course, the floral aromas and also the earthiness of the bulb, because we make it not from the flower, but we make it from the bulb. Can you see? Can see. Yeah, and what we do it before the flower grows. So inside the tulip bulb, when you cut it open, you will see a little flower already there. It just has to come out. So we make it from the bulb, but you have the aroma also from the flower. So you get the earthiness of the earth, and you get the whole experience.
Wow, sounds very interesting. And I've understood that you're also a sustainable entrepreneur. Can you tell me something about the sustainability of this process?
Yeah, it's not the first story we tell, because we believe that the first story is it's a really good vodka from tulip bulbs. And then the second story is we use organic tulip bulbs, which are grown organic. We produce a vodka from it, and what we have left over from this distillation process, which is a pulp, it's boiled down, it goes to as fodder for cows, for the local farmer near our distillery who has cows. He gives it, so we don't produce any waste. And also, we are looking on which tulip bulbs should we buy, so we can optimize, of course, the harvest yield, because there are not so many organic tulip farmers in Holland, and certainly not so many who produce so many bulbs that we can actually make vodka from it, because we need a lot of tulip bulbs.
Okay, it sounds very interesting, and let's have a taste later on.
Oh, yeah?
My last question would be, what would be your favorite way? Drink it in a cocktail or with a tonic? What's your favorite drink?
Yeah, well, that's really difficult to say. It depends on the moment.
Okay.
Sometimes I really enjoy drinking it just pure, just the way it is. But I really like the cocktail with ginger beer. So it's, you take ginger beer, you add a little bit of fresh lime, then the vodka, then some Angostura bitters, and then you top it off with some fresh mint, and you get a really nice Moscow Mule, because that's a classic. It's a Moscow Mule cocktail, but with a unique flavor of tulips.
Well, thank you very much for sharing, Joris.
Okay, thank you for being here. Bye-bye.
Bye. And next, we'll have Ariane back, because she will tell us about the 2022 exhibition in the Mauritshuis on flowers.
Yes, flower still lives. Yes, in next year, 2022, it's going to be the jubilee year of the Mauritshuis. 200 years ago it was founded, the museum. So what better way to celebrate the anniversary of the museum than with an exhibition of Dutch and Flemish flower still lives of the 17th century. The Mauritshuis has a big collection of flower paint. It's actually the most beautiful collection of Dutch and Flemish flower still lives in any museum in the world. So it seems quite a good choice to have an exhibition to celebrate that year and celebrate the wonderful flowers from the Netherlands and the beautiful art that were produced with those flowers. And in the exhibition, we're not only going to show the flower still lives of the 17th century, the different types, the different artists and all of that, but we also are going to talk a lot about the context of flower still lives, of how they were rooted very much into the in botanical science, the discovery of new species, the history of botanical studies, and the Hortus in Leiden, the Hortus in different in Hortus Botanicus in Amsterdam, the tulipomania that I just talked about, the craze for tulips at the time, and there's many stories to be told when it concerns art and flowers. We begin the exhibition with the beginnings of the genre. You see a very early work here, a portrait actually by Hans Memling. And on the backside of that panel, there's a painted a flower in a small pot. It is very religious. The man was used to be praying towards the Virgin and Child, so it's all very much in the context of religion. It has the monogram of Jesus Christ on that pot, IHS, and the flowers in the pot are all, like the lily, for instance, are all symbols of the Virgin Mary. And on the right, you see a very early work as well by Joris Hoefnagel, who was an artist who was also a botanist. So in this person, there's really the connection between art and botany. And it shows, that's one of the lines in the exhibition, how art and science go hand in hand in this genre. Flower still lives begin actually after 1600. Before that, that is the beginning of the golden age of Dutch painting. Before that, we just showed you the one picture by Hans Memling, but it wasn't actually a specialty in Dutch art. But it began straight after 1600. And I show you here three early works by different artists, including Ambrosius Bossart, who was a painter from Middelburg, and he was the first man who specialized only in flower still lives. So that was the only theme that he painted. And the different flowers are all arranged in beautiful bouquets. Each individual flower is painted after life, so it's really realistic. You can determine the different species by looking at those paintings, but the arrangement bouquet with all those flowers that actually bloom in different seasons is not true to life. But that's very typical. All the variety, the number, the exotic flowers, there's a great preference for exotic flowers, and you remember that the tulip was also an exotic flower. Now it's a completely common and very well known flower in the Netherlands, of course, but at that time it was really new and hugely expensive. So that not only the paintings were really for the upper market of art collectors, but also such arrangements of flowers which you wouldn't really see in real life, because those flowers were extremely expensive, extremely rare, and it would be silly to cut off those blooming flowers and put them in a vase like in this painting. So it's a really construction. And of course, art outlives nature in a certain way, because you can also enjoy those still lives in wintertime when there are no flowers there. And one of the storylines I told you is that the Hortus Botanicus, Carolus Clusius, the man, the great scholar who described all of those new species and published about them, we have a number of those prints and early books that were extremely important for collectors of flowers, for artists, books with different species described and drawn in prints and drawings quite precisely. With the, you can see the daffodil on in the middle with the different bulbs. So it's all about science and discovery of new species and how those were offered to clients and to different people. Another theme in the exhibition are the woman artists, because it's quite remarkable that in flower paintings at the time, there were quite a number of women that were active as artists. And not only were they active from the 16th century already within gardens and the collecting of flowers and all of that, but also as artists. For instance, the sisters Rachel and Anna Ruys, they were both the daughters of a man called Frederik Ruys, who was a professor of botany in the late 17th century in Amsterdam. So those daughters were quite, they could discover all those new species, all those beautiful flowers close by at home. And Rachel Ruys actually became the best known female painter of flowers still alive of the 17th century. And she was extremely active and extremely talented. And she had not only had 10 children, but also managed to have a huge oeuvre of flowers still alive that were sought after and bought by different princes all around Europe. So it's really the high level of the market. So that's a very interesting story to be told in the exhibition. And another story is the late 17th century, the Amsterdam Hortus, which was founded a little less than a century after the one in Leiden. And you see the print on the left, it really illustrates how everybody, the flowers, the bulbs are brought in, that is described, the different books, they're all studying them. It was a huge thing to all be studying the different flowers, the different plants. Of course, the Hortus also had a very important function in terms of medicine. And for pharmacists, the different species. It was not just the beauty of those flowers and plants, but also the use that they had for medication. And we'll have in the exhibition as for the Amsterdam Hortus, they not only collected dried flowers in album, but also commissioned different artists, and there was also quite a large number of women that were active, to illustrate the different flowers in the Hortus in Amsterdam. And this collection of albums was survived the 17th century, and we'll have show that story as well. So it's the beautifully depicted different species, and you see that the description of that plant is on the left side of the album. So that's that story of discovery, of talking, exchange between different people, networking about flowers and plants, exchanging seeds, exchanging bulbs, and art that you know, artists that had to be involved as botanists, but also to illustrate a different types. This is a beautiful painting by Michiel van Musser with his family, with his wife and daughter, which illustrates how women were active in gardens and with that art. And you see his daughter here, that's the mother holds up a flower and a daughter has drawn that flower on a piece of paper. So the two of them are involved with the garden, involved with the different plants, the collecting, and also the art that was the product also of the garden. Gardening, and this is a wonderful illustration of that story and a painting that we'll have in the exhibition. And but of course, it's a huge celebration, and we have a show of the most beautiful flower still lifes of the time. Here, for instance, two paintings by Abraham Mignon, also from the collection of the Mauritshuis, which go back from the collection of the early stadtholders in the 18th century. So it's a long history in the collection. Those paintings were collected by princes, by the top market of art collectors, and extremely precious and beautiful, and people really love those paintings. So it's really going to be a wonderful celebration of the art of flower painting next year in the Mauritshuis.
Great. Well, let's hope we will be able to travel again and to visit the exhibition.
Yes, I really hope so.
Thank you very much. And to close off, I promise to have a last view at what Doreen is creating in her greenhouse.
Yes, I have been listening to everybody, but also like, this is for me the latest Dutch art when you talk about flowers. Because like how they did the tulips in the 17th century, here I'm using one of these beautiful dried pieces just from my backyard. And I still don't know what it is because it's just growing wild. I haven't found it out. And I don't know if you know what this one is, but that's just a cauliflower that grows along the side. And the bouquet that I made is just kind of romance, but I love to play then with a different kind of culture in the bouquet to be more surprising. And there are tulips and daffodils and roses, these beautiful queen roses. And just to see for you to add this little flower in between, I can still open my hand. I don't have to do this for 10 more minutes, okay, there's a flower falling. Don't be worried because flowers are strong. There's nothing happening with this daffodil. And then to add just a little bit a flower from out of your garden or just out of the wild, it's, I first use a band because the bouquet is heavy and then it's easier to make it later with a nice rope. So I don't have to hold it too tight in my hand. And I also look for the ropes, that they are nice fitting with the bouquet. I think every bouquet is a piece of art if you put the love of your flowers in it. Because I think that's all about the flower art. It's the love that you give to all the flowers. Because I'm definitely in love with flowers. I'm in lovely love with my husband, but with flowers also. It's maybe my second, now the children first and then flowers. But I haven't, yeah. But now, for me, the vase and how it fits beautiful with this bubbling face, and then you know already a little bit the trend for 2022. And it's just narrow enough to fit it all in. I left the stems in different length. So, and you still can add some flowers. I know, I use a lot of flowers, but that's why I'm from Holland. And I just love it, so.
Wow. Thank you. Doreen, we love it too. Thank you very much. And I would say, do try this at home to the people.
Yeah, please, just play. It's all.
Thank you very much. Well, I hope we've shown you the love for flowers in this masterclass. And also that there's more to Dutch flowers than only the tulips in spring, who are also very beautiful, of course, right now. We will send you the link to the live stream, more information in a digital press kit. If you have any questions that are not already answered, please contact your MBTC PR manager. And remember, if you want to share your posts on social media, do it with the hashtag DutchFlowersNow. Thank you all for watching, and I hope to see you here in Westland or in another flower region in the Netherlands when it's safe to travel again. Hopefully soon. Goodbye. Thank you.